tonight we're swanning around Sideshows, Stunts and Scavenger Hunts. Let's meet the fairground attractions. Roll up, roll up, it's Rosie Jones. The wild man of Croydon, Nish Kumar. The freak of nature that is Gyles Brandreth. And the star of Ferris Wheel's Day Off, Alan Davis. Right, let's hear how much fun you're all having, Nish goes. You can't help yourself but start doing that.
You've got a bounce to that.
Rosie goes. Gyles goes. And Alan goes. how did this woman pick up men?
Ooh. Ooh. Is it going to be with her teeth or something?
Well, you're heading in the right.
Am I?
Oh. Heading in the right direction. Yes. This is one of the great acts of all time. Ah,
it's a strong woman of some kind.
It's the very first female bodybuilder.
The first female bodybuilder. And doesn't she look, if I may say so, are we allowed to make personal remarks or will I have to apologise?
She's dead, so I think it's fine.
Yeah. Fine. She was a fine figure of a woman.
She's called Katie Brumbach, a.k.a. the Great Sandwina. And if we pull out on this picture, we can see that there's rather more to her than we had first anticipated. And what I like is her act involved picking up her 5'6" husband and twirling him over her head. I think it's a fine way to make a living.
Sorry, I feel like I need to say it.
Yes.
She's fit. That waist, those arms, or the thing she could do with me.
She's an extraordinary woman. She was born in Vienna. She was the daughter of a strong man and a strong woman in the service. She was the second of 16 children.
Whoa.
Her father could reportedly lift more than 500 pounds with a single finger.
What? Wow.
I know, right? She started the barn in Bailey's Circus, and in her spare time, she became the vice president of the circus's suffrage movement.
Oh, wow.
And her husband, Max, would tell a story. I suspect it's a tall tale, that he met her when he took on the challenge of wrestling her with the hopes of winning 100 marks. And when she threw him to the ground, they immediately realised that they loved each other. And that there was a good double act in it, I think. Have a look at this picture. We've got her underneath a human bridge. There she is.
Whoa.
No.
Basically, she's a good egg.
Yeah.
She was a good egg. She was a feminist. She was a suffragette. And she did good works for the cause of strong women.
And she was fit.
You know, we're all stronger than we realise. I learnt this when I was a very little boy because I was born in Germany after the Second World War, the late 1940s. Not a lot of work for the circuses. And my parents engaged a couple to look after me as a sort of nanny and governess. And they were strong people from the local circus. So almost the first things I learnt were to walk the tightrope, to stand on my head, and to be a strong baby. We can all do this experiment now. Put your hand on your head.
Okay.
Like this.
Oh, I've got to find my head.
Now, with your other hand, attempt to lift your arm off your head. From underneath, just push it aside. Please do this at home if you're watching. You can't do it, can you?
No.
You really cannot do it. The strongest person in the world, that strong woman, could not lift my hand from my head. It's all done with mechanics. They're not particularly strong at all. That's the trick I learnt when I was 2, and I'm pleased after all these years to be able to share it with you now.
Someone told you that when you were 2.
Yes.
And you remembered it.
Yes.
How?
I treasured it.
Yeah. I don't.
Never ask Gyles a follow-up question. Sandwina herself had 2 children, and in fact, her first, Theodore Roosevelt Sandwina, when he was 2, he weighed 3.5 stone, 50 pounds, wow. And he could pick up a 25-pound dumbbell. Sandwina actually got her name. Her real name is Katie Brumbach. She got it from the very first male professional.
Oh, Eugene Sandow.
Yes, indeed.
Yes.
There he is. Look at that. Yeah, I mean, there's a use of blue tack.
Hang on, are we just blind? How did you know that?
Because he was my great uncle's godfather. not frankly that he looked. He didn't come to the christening, I'm sure, you dressed like that.
Giles, I've wanted to ask you this for a long time, and I want you to give me a straight answer. Are you quite literally Forrest Gump?
No relation of any kind, but Eugene Sandow and my great-great-uncle, I've got that generation right, they knew one another.
He was incredibly famous. Even today, the Mr. Olympia competition, the trophy is a statue of Sandow. The legend has it that Eugene Sandow and Katie Brumbach once had a competition to lift a 300-pound weight, and she won.
Wow.
And so she referred to herself as the great Sandwina. But this guy, he could do a somersault holding a 24-kilo dumbbell in each hand. He would sometimes lift a dumbbell. It had a huge sphere on each end, and when he put it down, a grown man would walk out of each of the spheres. I mean, he could lift a grand piano with an orchestra of eight on top.
Is he enormous? It's hard to tell there. Whether it was he 7 foot tall? Or
I think he wasn't that big, and the leaf isn't that big. He wasn't that big.
OK. Now, Giles.
Yes?
Tell me, what's the best way to win a non-stop speaking competition?
Oh, look,
there's
a picture of me in younger and happier days making the longest speech in the history of the world. I spoke on that occasion only for about 3.5 hours.
Oh.
I then broke the record again, speaking for 7 hours, then for 8 hours, then for 11 hours. I shared that record with Nicholas Parsons. And eventually I retired when I'd spoken non-stop for 12.5 hours.
Did you actually make notes or do you just...
No. You had to do it without notes, without repetition, and keeping the audience there, that was the challenge, and also staying there through the night. Mm. And
did you have a wee, darling?
That's the whole problem. Mm. I knew I'd need to go to the loo. But this was for a charity, and they supplied me with an appliance that you strap around. It's given to field marshals.
And babies.
It's full size. For field marshals on cold parade grounds. Old men. It's a sort of tube thing.
Isn't that uncomfy?
Well, it initially, but it's quite exciting, actually, as the evening wears on.
Do you know, it's really funny. They said, see if Giles can be persuaded to reminisce. And he will. Well, non-stop competitive speaking is a sort of lesser-known sibling of the dance marathon craze. There was a thing in 1928 called the Noun and Verb Rodeo, and it took 4 days. And you could say whatever you wanted as long as you spoke for 22.5 hours a day. Could you do that, do you think?
Yeah, certainly.
Don't start, I mean...
But wouldn't that be exciting? We could do it here and break a record and do something useful for a change.
But repetition was allowed. There was one woman who repeatedly recited the part of Lady M until she passed out. Another competitor used his words to propose to a fellow player who used her time to explain why she wasn't interested. And the third said something so offensive, they had to have him arrested for loose talking. In fact, as far as I know, the longest speech is a filibuster in the United States Senate.
Yeah.
Which was a man called Storm Thurmond of South Carolina, yep. US senator in 1957. And he spoke for 24 hours and 18 minutes. It's a record that still stands. But he's not my favourite person because he spoke against the Civil Rights Act.
Yeah. What a prick.
Yes.
It's like one of those Olympic records where the person was on steroids. Yeah. Like, it definitely should come with a big old asterisk.
Yeah. I mean, don't speak ill of the dead apart from him.
You know, I'm gonna say it right here, right now. I think I can beat that because all I need to do is say like 4 sentences.
Absolutely. That is one of the ways of doing it. Just take it very slowly indeed. For me, the challenge really was keeping the audience awake, as you can imagine, because that was the rule. They had to stay, you know.
Sorry, I drifted off. I wasn't listening. So lots of competitive crazes in the United States. The late 1930s, swallowing live goldfish was a competitive craze. Ooh. This guy, whose name is Lothrop Withington, he was a freshman at Harvard. He said he settled his stomach with some mashed potato. before he swallowed. Yeah, don't do this, OK? It's not nice. And also, in this country, you'll be, I think, arrested and banned from keeping animals.
The young man who brought the goldfish looks a bit put out.
He does look a bit...
Well, no-one said anything about this. Have you got a fish? I said, yes, I've got Jeffrey, and I'll bring
him. What I love is this guy looks so sort of trendy and everything, so I had a look to see what happened to him later in life. There's a terrible interview when he's an old man interviewed about his collection of antique spoon moulds. And you just think, oh, you were so exciting in 1930. Now look at you. But it was a craze. The final record before it was completely banned was a student swallowing 210 fish in one sitting. Another swallowing phenomenon of the era is one of my favourite vaudeville acts of all time, the great Haji Ali, the great regurgitator. So this guy, he was billed as the Egyptian Enigma. One of the things I like about him is this is Judy Garland's favourite vaudeville act, OK? So he would swallow...
I love him!
I think he's fabulous! He would swallow increasingly improbable things and then reproduce them in an order specified by the audience.
Oh, brilliant.
So he could swallow 50 hazelnuts and an almond and bring the almond up at the moment requested by the audience. Yeah. And his greatest...
What a great show!
Oh, I love the almond!
Why all these pictures have to be three men in suits who appear to have nothing to do with it? Just to bulk out the crowd.
Yeah. His greatest trick, right, he would swallow some kerosene, then some water, then he would regurgitate the kerosene, set it on fire, regurgitate the water from 6 feet away, and put the fire out.
How do you discover you're good at that?
This is Lepetomane in reverse, isn't it?
It is exactly Lepetomane in reverse.
Lepetomane was a similar period, I think.
Yes, I think it's about
a similar vintage of act. And he was somebody who broke wind.
Yeah.
Out of his backside, Lepetomane could blow out candles at a distance.
Well, Johnny, he could do the whole of the Marseillaise, apparently.
Oh, yes.
You can do that.
No, I can't do that. I can't... Look, OK? Rosie and I spent a lot of 2018 and 19 on tour together and all that would happen is I'd have a Nando slightly too close to the show and, unfortunately, there wasn't as much privacy in the dressing rooms of the regional art centres of the United Kingdom. And so just every so often I'd hear Rosie go, can you not?
Why does Nando's make you effervescent?
Well, because I have it extra hot and I have it with a Coke and then the whole thing, it all goes a bit Petermain Kumar.
You cannot imagine the stench.
Stop speaking and goldfish swallowing are both forgotten sports and possibly should stay that
is
way.
Are some of my other records on your list?
No, darling. What are your other records?
Oh, well.
Oh, I can't believe I asked you that.
The longest ever screen kiss?
You?
Me?
Were you alone?
The record was held for many years by Regis Toomey and Jane Wyman, the first wife of Ronald Reagan.
Yes, indeed.
In a film called You're in the Army Now in the 1940s, they had an osculatory marathon that lasted about 2.5 minutes. And I thought it'd be rather fun to see if I could beat this on screen and be in the Guinness Book of Records again for the longest sustained screen kiss. And this was in the 1980s, and I was on a programme called TVAM with a lovely presenter, Anne Diamond. And she agreed on Valentine's Day to give it a go. And so we began kissing, the clock was ticking, but these were the early days of TVAM and we had a mission to explain, and unfortunately, about 2 minutes into our kiss, we had to go live to Moscow for coverage of President Brezhnev's funeral.
Okay, Brezhnev.
And it felt inappropriate. They wanted to put the picture in the corner of the screen.
Yes.
But actually, as Madame Brezhnev was weeping and the body was being put into the... They felt this was inappropriate. Anyway, so we did not break the record on that occasion. But a year later, I thought, I'm going to do it again. So here we are on Valentine's Day, and there is the lovely Cheryl Baker from Buck's Fizz.
I remember.
But she's still lovely. She's still brilliant.
And said no.
And said 2 minutes was enough.
And said, how's the Russian president?
Anyway, the long and the short of it is I've held the record for the longest ever screen kiss with Cheryl Baker.
And
thank you. Thank you.
you done screen kisses, Alan? It's so awkward.
Yes. I had to do a sex scene in a train toilet.
Oh.
With Leslie Sharp. It's a brilliant, brilliant actress and very nice to do a sex scene with. But it wasn't a real train toilet, it was a studio set. And so to get the idea that the train was moving, they had a light outside the window and a spark with a board just passing it in front of the light. And that's all I remember. It was all very heightened passion. And then there was just the other side was a man just going like...
Now you can't have sex without a man outside the window.
About 2 years after that, I would call him. I might be in luck tonight. Can you be at 3:30?
Right. Gyles obviously finds speaking easy, but now on to speak easies. Which of you would have made the best bootlegger?
I want to say Rosie Jones.
You would be right.
Oh, really?
Why might that be?
I just think she gets away with a huge amount because she looks like butter wouldn't melt in her mouth. But let me tell you, it would and it does.
Is it not to do with making illicit alcohol, then?
No, it's absolutely to do with making illicit alcohol.
But why would a female...
..do better?
Yes.
Is it because I'm a cute little lady?
It is.
And I'm like... Alcohol? No!
it's the reluctance of officers to search women.
Ah.
It was thought inappropriate even to search cars with women in them. And lots of women, I hard to believe, women took advantage of this. And they reckon female bootleggers outnumbered men by about 5 to 1. I mean, it was a really...
Really?
Yeah. In some states, it was illegal for women to be strip-searched, so they would provoke officers by saying, "Oh, it's hidden down the bra," or, you know, wherever, and threaten to sue the officers if... I don't know why I suddenly turned terrible.
Well, you're like, always like that with the police.
I know. The sworn enemies were two prohibition agents called Isidore Izzy Einstein and his partner Mo Smith, and there they are. They specialised in costumes... So they would turn up as German pickle packers, Hungarian violinists or whatever. My favourite is that several times Einstein, who's the one on the right, went into a bar and identified himself as a prohibition agent and the barman thought it was hilarious and let him in.
To be fair to those two gents, if they were going to disguise themselves as anything, it would be people who were too drunk at a bar.
Yeah. Yeah. But wait till you see some of the disguises. So look at this. I love the one on the right.
Oh, yes.
That's very some like it hot, isn't it?
Is it?
Yeah. Anybody know another country that enforced prohibition? Iceland. Huh? Banned all alcohol in 1915. So 20 years, they didn't have alcohol at all. 1935, they legalised everything except strong beer. And full-strength beer was only legalised in 1989.
Really?
Yeah.
They come late to a lot of things. I think I'm right in saying that they didn't allow television on Thursday nights until quite recently. And they wanted people to read books on Thursday nights, have a drink and
read
a book.
Well, one of the things that they did do was once a month, particularly in Reykjavik, they would turn out all the streetlights and somebody would give a lecture on the National Public Radio about the stars that evening, and the lights were all turned out so that everybody could see the constellations clearly.
Oh, wow!
And I think that is a really lovely thing.
Yeah. That's amazing.
I went as a guest of the Prime Minister in Iceland, and my wife and I went, and we were staying with the Prime Minister and her wife, so there was just the four of us in their equivalent of Chequers. And we were shown upstairs to bed by the Prime Minister. She said, "Here are the spare towels, here is the bathroom. Or if you get up in the night, don't touch the red button." I said, "Oh, what happened?" She said, "The SAS will come." what career skills can you pick up at a fun fair?
Yeah. Fun fair. So not a circus, more a fun fair. Yes. More rides and coconut shies.
Yeah. Exactly
and
that, my darling.
Sort of thing.
Exactly that.
For your career as a someone who throws things?
Well, I think the fact that the woman is riding a machine is a bit of a clue. It's flying.
What?
I know. It seems extraordinary. The first ever plane-themed funfair rides were invented to train pilots to actually fly real plane. There was an American engineer in 1931 called Lee Ierley, and he invented a device called the orientator. And so it was a small model of a plane, and it could tilt and turn and roll while stuck in a sort of Y-shaped fork. This is an extraordinary picture because this is Amelia Earhart in his training machine, and the Cuban government ordered 5 of them to train their air force, and it is the only 5 that he ever sold, Eily. Wow. Nobody else was interested, and then a friend of his convinced him that actually it would do better if he turned it into a carnival ride. It was renamed the Acroplane, and it sold 10 times as many as when it was a training simulator.
Is it the same for driving a car and dodging?
Exactly the same, darling. Yes, learn that. Just go for it, hit anybody, I think is the way I do have a particular interest in these plane rides because the machine gun inventor, Sir Hiram Maxim, that's him with the white beard there, he built a fairground ride with gondolas which spun. It sort of flew by virtue of a centrifugal force. And in fact, his captive flying machines are a Blackpool ride. They're still operating today. It's possibly the oldest fairground ride in Europe. And the guy who built it for him is the guy in the other bowler hat, and his name is Field Trickett, and that is my great-grandfather.
Oh, wow! You're turning into me.
I am that.
Absolutely. Yes. I mean, you and the Prime Minister of Iceland, you and your grandpa.
That's very exciting. Right. Which is easier to do, get a sonic boom out of a potato, unboil an egg, or eat your own umbilical cord?
Oh. Is that what an umbilical cord looks like?
Not the one in the middle. Have you not seen one?
No.
No.
I was forced to cut the umbilical cord.
Oh, yes.
Of my unborn children, recently born.
It's quite tough.
Ooh. Very sharp little scissors.
Yeah.
You know our friend Brian Blessed. Mm. He cut an umbilical cord with his own teeth.
Why?
Because he was... This is a true story. And if were he here, he would tell it to you more concisely. he was on a walk and a lady was giving birth and in some discomfort. He went to the rescue. With his beard ready, tickled her through the last moments. And the baby was born, and he realised he was alone. Somehow, the umbilical cord had to be cut, and he bit through the umbilical cord with his teeth. And I think he keeps a little bit of it in a sort of jam jar at home.
Please stop. So we're talking about the University of Chicago's Scavenger Hunt. It is possibly the most challenging scavenger hunt on the entire planet. The challenges have included in building a nuclear reactor and getting yourself circumcised. Both have been achieved. It's the gold standard of scavenger hunts, frankly. It's fiendishly hard. First of all, because they don't tell you what the list is. You have to find the list yourself. And there are about 300 items to either find or do a quest each year. So over the years, the challenges have included unboiling an egg. Now, we've done this, Alan. We did unboil an egg on the show.
How does one do that?
What you do is you inject urea into the egg.
Piss!
Yes, darling, I said urea just to be nice. Yes. I used another four-letter word that I thought made me look cleverer. What it does is it breaks down the bonds of protein and then you have to spin it. Do you remember that? Zero? No. OK.
Why did you two wee on it?
We have people for that.
OK. I was going to say a myth that I pissed.
Somebody had to get a potato to break the sound barrier. Somebody had to get a live lion, tiger and bear into the same place on campus. And one person had to eat their own umbilical cord, which they did manage because it turned out their mother had kept it as a souvenir and he put it in an American cake called a Twinkie and ate it.
Oh. Wow.
Sorry, but why?
So you asked that question because you're not a boy at university. Nobody's found a way to get the potato to break the sound barrier yet. Although, do you know how McDonald's make their French fries, which I've just discovered? They fire them at 75 miles an hour through a grid of knives that chop them.
What?
Yes.
Oh.
I know. That's good, isn't it?
It's quite exciting.
It's rather good
fact. I should watch that.
Anyway, the building a nuclear reactor, 1999, a pair of physics students at Chicago earned 500 points by building a working nuclear reactor in their dorm using scrap aluminium and carbon sheets, and it was capable of producing high-grade uranium.
What?
So we're going to try and get you two guys to do something. Oh. You should have two balloons. This is not exactly a nuclear reactor, but, you know, just to start simple. I want you to take your two balloons, or tell me how you would, take your two balloons and turn them into a pair of slippers.
I'm going to go ahead and assume
yep.
it isn't just a case of wham your feet in.
putting your foot into the balloon.
Yeah, just straight in the balloon.
No, because it would break.
Do you chop your foot off?
Chop your foot off! Chop your foot off!
Chop your foot off! Put it in the blender.
How can I say this? No.
It's never a good sign when she goes quiet for a bit.
Yeah, just having a think there. I mean, you'd have to be desperate to win, Rosie, for that.
Oh, do it!
Let's have a look at how you do it. OK, this is a very straightforward trick. So you blow the balloon up and get the friend to just hold it like that and then let the air out.
Oh!
Is that clever?
That's brilliant.
Oh, that's good.
What attractive slippers they are, too.
They're perfectly nice, aren't they? It's a good job I didn't ask you to make a nuclear reactor.
I mean, are you into this sort of thing?
I
was just
thinking, I love puzzles and games. Love
No, I was brooding about the circumcision thing.
Oh. I think it was boys only, darling.
Recently, Mothering Sunday,
yes.
I saw some flowers in the window of a shop, and I went in and I said, can I have some flowers? And they said, no, we don't sell flowers. I said, there are flowers in the window. They said, we are a circumcision clinic. What do you expect us to put in the window?
So the scavenger hunt, as a sort of an idea, was a brainchild of a marvellous woman called Elsa Maxwell. She was one of the great party hostesses of the 20th century. And there she is in the middle. There she is with Cole Porter. And she threw the very first one in Paris in 1927. And the items included somebody had to get a black swan from the Bois de Boulogne Park.
Do we get a bonus for knowing who the other fellow is?
Is it your granddad?
No, it's a man called William Larder.
Who?
That's all we know about him, apart from he liked to smoke cigarettes. So you had to get a black swan from the Bois de Boulogne, a shoe of the music hall star Miss Tanguette. Do you know about Miss Tanguette?
I do know about Miss Tanguette. She was a great favourite of Maurice Chevalier.
She was, in her day, the highest paid female entertainer in the world, yeah. And hardly anybody knows about her now.
Wow.
They had to try and get a shoe of hers, a red pom-pom from a sailor's hat and so on. And riotous scenes across Paris ensued because of this thing. And the police came to interview Elsa Maxwell and said, what on earth are you doing? And then she named the guests at her party, and it included the chief of police's nephew and the mayor's son. That was the end of it. The University of Chicago scavenger hunt stunts are usually completed by a bunch of undergraduates. What looks like a scrotum and loves doing press-ups?
Oh, Nish.
Can I just say, yeah. I do not enjoy press-ups, so I don't know where you've got that from.
That's ridiculous. Any other thoughts?
It's going to be something from the animal kingdom, is it?
Yeah.
Something wrinkly and undersea.
Underwater, certainly. It's the pleasingly named Titicaca water frog.
It's my favourite one.
Its nickname is the scrotum frog. There it is. You can see its skin looks much too big.
If you're looking at your scrotum and you're seeing eyes, go to the doctor.
Yeah. If you're looking at your scrotum and it's looking back
at you. Yeah, it's looking back at you, yeah.
Well, this frog spends its entire life in the water of Lake Titicaca, which is between Peru and Bolivia, 12,500 feet above sea level, so there we are there. It never leaves the lake, so it goes for its whole life under the surface.
Oh, is that why it's all shriveled up, as it were?
It's partly that, but there's relatively little oxygen in the lake. So the frog's huge skin surface allows it to absorb as much oxygen as possible through the skin. If it ever needs extra oxygen, it has two options. It can surface briefly to breathe through its tiny lungs, or it can do press-ups at the bottom of the lake to disturb the water around it, and so there's more oxygen which can reach the skin. How cute is that? Just thinks, oh, I'm a bit out of breath. The frogs came to fame in 1968 when Jacques Cousteau visited, and he estimated at the time that there was about a billion frogs in the lake.
In one lake?
What? Well, you're talking about 2 million acres of lake, so it's a lot of lake.
Big lake.
There is possibly as few as 50,000 left.
Oh. No.
Yeah, it's such a shame. Pollution, humans hunting them for food, invasive trout eating their tadpoles and so on, and they're trying to work out how to save them.
People eat these, do they? Are they a delicacy?
Yeah, apparently so. Denver Zoo just hatched their first ever scrotum frogs in 2017.
Oh, wow.
Do you remember poet W.H. Auden had a face lined, absolutely covered with lines, like a crisscross? Noel Coward said, picture his face. Now imagine his scrotum. I have a sort of scrotum aversion, I must say.
Well, finally we found something we have in common.
Well, you remember our mutual friend Maureen Lipman's wonderful line, what's the worst thing about oral sex? The view.
Now, here's a bit of a spectacle. How do you think a fight between a submarine and a stallion would go?
Stallion's a horse.
Yes.
A submarine is a submersible ship.
Nothing gets past you.
They rarely meet.
So there are a couple of instances where they have met. So 1915, there was a British submarine which fought and lost a battle to Turkish cavalry.
What?
Yeah. So, British Captain Lieutenant Commander Martin Dunbar Naismith... Not your godfather.
The Dunbar Naismith.
Now, you're going to think I'm inventing this.
I'm afraid that submarine might have sailed, Gyles.
This man was born on the 1st of April, 1883. He won the Victoria Cross. Yes. And I know about him because I live in the house in which this man was born. In
what? No! No!
True. It's absolutely true. And anyway, he was a great man. And he had many adventures in submarines. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyway, it was extraordinary, but he on one occasion, in 1915, he was attacking shipping outside Constantinople harbour, and the Turkish cavalry unit appeared on a cliff nearby. They spotted the sub and started attacking and started firing, and the submarine had to retreat. So he was beaten back by the Turkish cavalry. But horseman aside, he was an exceptional captain at one point. The crew, and this is such a good idea, captured a Turkish sailing vessel, a dhow, and they tied it to the sub's conning tower to act as camouflage. And so when they were approaching enemy vessels, people thought that was just a Turkish dhow approaching. And then they worked out that when they weren't attacking people, they could use the captured boat, which is attached to the conning tower, to go up and stretch their legs.
Oh my God.
But he also had apart from resourcefulness, Naismith had a tremendous reputation for gallantry. So he always used to present boxes of chocolates to any women travelling as passengers on Turkish ships that they'd captured. He just thought that was polite to do that.
I feel like we've really breezed past the fact that this whole show has turned into, like, a posh white version of Slumdog Millionaire. Like...
There's the film they should have made.
Yeah, a film called Posh White Millionaire.
It must have been extraordinary on those submarines, though, because navigation was incredibly basic, so it was too risky to surface with the periscope most of the time. And so the crew found their way literally by bumping along the bottom of the sea and trying to match the bumps with the contours on the map. And ammunition was so limited, if you fired a torpedo and it missed its target and it floated in the water, somebody'd swim out and get it and bring it back. They baked bread daily in an electric oven, but they did not have enough electricity to both power the oven and to run at full speed, so you either had to choose between bread or speed.
Oh, bread! Yeah.
I know. Horses were actually transported on submarines in the same year.
I bet they love that.
They were taken from Britain to the Battle of Gallipoli in the Dardanelles, 10 horses at a time in a submarine.
Wow.
There were 16 days to get there. They stopped for a couple of hours in Malta so the horses could stretch their legs.
Wow.
Yeah. It's not the only time that the Navy and the cavalry have fought each other. So the Battle of Texel took place just off Texel Island, which is north of Amsterdam. 1795, French and Dutch were at war, and it was winter. And when the Dutch invasion fleets, there was about 14 ships, when they dropped anchor in a strait just off this port of Den Helder, the water froze and trapped them in place. And the French cavalry got wind of this and they approached overnight and they put cloth on the horses' hooves. Wow. So that no noise was made as they approached over the ice. And the Dutch woke up to find themselves surrounded on the frozen ice by the cavalry.
Wow.
And they surrendered immediately. What do you think would happen if two submarines battled each other underwater?
Is it like practical shit?
No, I don't.
What, do you think they're both sat there going, D3?
Oh, damn it! You win!
The real problem is, until recently, very hard to tell how deep the other sub is submerged. Because
oh,
they're,
really? You don't know where it is?
No, exactly, but it has happened. 1945, the British sub HMS Venturer met the U-864 off a Norwegian island and they fired six torpedoes pretty much at random. And unfortunately, the German sub dived to get out of the way and accidentally went into one of the torpedoes. Although, can I just say, the Germans had the right idea. Not all their U-boats were engaged in deadly activities. They had the submarine U-1231, and it was a North Atlantic travelling off licence. It used to go around and deliver
booze. The party boat?
Yes. It delivered booze to the other U-boats. Right. It's time to enter the horrible hall of mirrors that is general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. Which country are ponchos from?
Mexico.
Should we go through other countries?
Let's do lots of countries.
Central and South America. Bolivia.
Bolivia, no.
Portugal.
No.
Peru.
England. England. I wanted to be England. I wanted to be England.
Is it Denmark?
No.
Give us a
what did you say then?
Peru.
Is correct.
Greatest moment of my life. Yes!
You knew that, right? Wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I actually got a few follow-up questions about how you knew it.
No, no, it's not all about me.
Lots of claims about who invented the poncho in the West. We most associate it with Mexico today. But the first came from Peru's Paracas Peninsula in... You knew all this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm really bored now.
So the oldest recorded poncho is about 2,500 years old. Initially for nobility and embroidered with the shamanic
figures.
They
say recorded. I mean, in what?
Well, it's very difficult to find fabric in archaeology. There's a problem with women's craft generally in history that a lot of those things just perish and disappear. Mm. The ones that we know about, the oldest recorded ponchos, they come from preserved mummy bundles of Paracas.
Really?
And the bundle would be multiple layers of highly embroidered fabric and textiles. I mean, it could be as much as 5 foot high and 7 foot across.
Frustratingly, I've just remembered a story from my travels.
No one cares!
I care, Nish.
This is why your chat show is never going to take off.
Most famous poncho in the world? Clint Eastwood.
Of course. Yeah.
Of course, for his spaghetti western trilogy. He still has it. He's had it for 55 years and never washed it. That's...
And what about the poncho?
Hey!
He's about 100 years old, I think.
He's still working, though, isn't
still
he?
Still carrying on, yeah. Yes, I know, just like Alan. Right. Now, what's the highest British mountain?
Oh. See, it's not going to be the one we think it is.
What do you think it is?
I think it's Ben Nevis.
And then it's not going to be there.
There you are.
Is it not Richard me. Osman?
It's Richard Osman standing on Ben Nevis.
What country did you speak of?
I said British Mountain, but I did not say inside Britain.
No.
In a territory. Very good.
Yes, British Overseas Territory.
So.
The British Overseas Territory of South Georgia has Mount Paget, which is 2,935 metres above sea level, so twice the height of Ben Nevis. The British Antarctic Territory contains Mount Hope, 3,239 metres. Bit of a vexed question as to whether or not it's British, because there's only four other countries which recognise it as such. It's certainly the highest mountain that Britain claims to own.
Sure.
Mount Hope got a boost in 2017. They remeasured it. You know how children keep growing? Yeah, Mount Hope, they found that it was 377 metres taller than they thought.
Wow. A lot.
Did they stand the mountain against the fridge in the kitchen?
Yes. Thing. No, to be fair, 1936, when they first measured it, they used dog sleds and simple tools. In 2017, they used satellites. So I think it's fair. It's fair enough. Even excluding the mountains in the British Antarctic Territory, there are so many higher peaks in South Georgia and St Helen that Ben Nevis doesn't even make the top 10 British mountains.
Sucks to be you, Ben Nevis.
But here's the thing. Ben Nevis, right, so there's some volunteers, 2006, they're picking litter off the slopes of Ben Nevis and they suddenly came across a church organ. OK. Yeah, quite near the summit. It was entirely by itself. This is obviously... obviously.
I love it. We're so gullible. We were like, whoa!
Was a local Highland Games athlete called Kenny Campbell, and he said he carried it up the mountain for charity in 1971. It took him 4 days. When he got there, he played Scotland the Brave, and then he couldn't be asked to bring it back home again.
Well, don't blame him. Someone else could go and get it.
Stop bringing that down again. Now, where's the biggest fire in the solar system? Yes, darling.
Is it the sun?
The sun isn't on fire.
It's not on fire.
Is it not?
The sun's not on fire.
So what it does, every second it uses up 700 million tonnes of the hydrogen inside it in a reaction which produces energy and light, but it's a nuclear reaction, not a chemical one, which is what fire is. And that applies to all the other stars that we can see too.
That's a lot of hydrogen.
It's a lot of hydrogen.
I'm worried about the amount of hydrogen.
It used to be that oxygen levels were higher on Earth than the 21% that they are today. And it's a good thing that it's not higher, because if it was 25%, for example, then even wet plants could burn. And so in the late Paleozoic era, the levels were 30 to 35%, and there were frequent catastrophic fires. So you don't want too much of it. But the reason that there seems to be, as far as we know, no fire in the solar system anywhere other than Earth, is that fire requires three things. It requires oxygen, it requires heat, and it requires something to burn, and there just isn't enough oxygen elsewhere. The only reason there's a meaningful amount of oxygen on Earth is photosynthesis, right? So there's no oxygen without life. So if there's no life elsewhere in the universe, there simply can't be any fire either.
You seem to know a lot, Sandy. Can you tell us when is the world going to end?
Tuesday.
I mean, is there going to be a cataclysm?
Possibly, darling, but in a million years. And I mean, you'll still be working, but I... Which brings us to the scores. Scavenging for scraps in last place with minus 16... It's Nish.
Boom. Oh. Minus 60.
In third place with minus 8, it's Gyles. In second place with minus 5, Alan. And in first place, with a positive 6 points, it's Rosie. Nish, Gyles and Alan, I leave you with this school day's sign-off from Eric Morecambe. When I was 8, I ran away with a circus. When I was 9, they made me bring it back. Good night.